Dear Facebook Pure Urology viewers, good evening one and all. As you all know, this week and next week we are having lot of good topics. Today we are starting with that flyer which we have sent with first topic, thulium fiber laser enucleation of the prostate. As you know very well that TURP is the gold standard, bipolar TURP is the most performed surgery, but there is a gap between the enucleation and bipolar TURP. Large gland, we all feel that we are resecting and we get bleeding, and somehow we finish because it is a easy surgery and most of us are trained, but at the end of the 1.5 hour we feel that it was bloody, we feel that we have spent time, we feel that too big gland and we left something, okay, patient will void. But enucleation in this area where more than 80 grams it is becoming more important. More so after using the dutasteride and finasteride, these glands are big by the time they present with retention. So even if we are doing less TURPs, we are doing for more bigger glands. So those bigger glands have given importance in last decade for enucleation. But for enucleation, people tried with holmium for long time, decades, because it is very fast and effective. The problem is, the usual norm is 100 watts means 1 crore, 120 watt means 1.2 crores. No conflicts of interest, but it is the truth. It is nothing but truth. We should have minimum 7 to 80 lakhs to buy the 100 watts laser. So it was not in anybody's cup of tea. Even I did not buy holmium laser for that reason. After that, enucleation bipolar has come. Some has done with manual mechanical rotation. Some have done with push and laser or the bipolar energy, but somehow people say that you have to use on the axis of the urethra and the membranous sphincter, you will be rotating against force. So now recently what happened, 3 years back thulium fiber laser has come. It came India very fast because CE approval was not necessary and it was safe and well used, and slowly in fact Western countries realized that this machine is doing well and they also approved, and slowly it became the talk of the town. Now today we wanted to know from Dr. Abhay Mahajan sir, who is experienced in using this thulium fiber laser and also enucleation. The main reason we have selected this topic is sir is expert. Recently it got very good appreciation in West Zone also, similar type of presentation. So let us the world listen from him how he does and what are the settings, what is the cost effectiveness, etc. Sir, good evening sir. Abhay Mahajan sir.
Good evening Chandramohan.
Sir, primarily we introduce ourselves because this is the most unofficial official program where we know each other. So for the audience, I know very well for last 10 years you and your presentation capabilities and surgical capabilities. For the audience across the world, where did you do your MS general surgery training, sir?
Yeah, Chandramohan, I did my MBBS, MS and MCH urology from Nair Hospital, Mumbai.
All the three from the same hospital.
Yes, I was in Nair Hospital for 12 years continuously till I finished my MCH urology. And then I was working as lecturer at KM Hospital, Mumbai for a period of 9 months. Okay, and then I left Mumbai and I came back to my hometown, Aurangabad, which is a small place in Maharashtra. And I'm practicing in Maharashtra, in Aurangabad since 1999.
Who are your contemporaries during your Sion? Any known contemporaries?
Yeah. My contemporary, my classmates during MCH urology were Dr. Nanjappa from Mumbai.
He's a very close
friend of mine. We were together during MCH urology. Then Mukund Andankar, who's professor at Nair Hospital at present. And working at Bombay Hospital also. Okay. Then Ganendra Sharma from Solapur, who is an expert in PCNL angles. Yes, he is my classmate. Then Dr. Dhiren Buch was from KM. He practices at Gujarat. He is one of my classmates. And two of our classmates are in US. One is Mohan Gundeti. You must have heard about
Mohan Gundeti. Mohan Gundeti, yes.
He is my classmate. And Dipen Parekh.
Both of them. Om Gundeti is a good pediatric surgeon.
Very good pediatric robotic.
Came to Hyderabad also. Yes. To Mallikarjun Reddy sir and all that.
Yes.
And You went to Aurangabad because it's your native place and you started from scratch, or you had your nursing home already with
No,
you?
no, no. My father is an engineer, so I had no contact, medical contact here. I
You
was
started from scratch.
absolutely scratch, and I came back because there was no urologist in Aurangabad. I was the first qualified urologist who entered practice in Aurangabad, so that attracted me actually.
What is that total population, sir, that time?
That time it was around 7 to 8 lakhs.
It's
Now
a
the
big place.
population,
That's quite big place then.
yeah, now it is 16 to 18 lakhs.
Oh, excellent.
18
It's
lakhs, yeah.
a growing industry in Aurangabad also.
Growing industry. It is actually, once upon a time, it was the fastest growing city in the world. It was coined for few duration, for 1 year's time. And the basic advantage of Aurangabad is we had two bigger corporate hospitals. One is from Videocon Group, the
Okay.
Videocon which makes TV, and they are from Aurangabad. So they started a corporate hospital. And second hospital was from Bajaj Group, Bajaj mopeds and rickshaws, and so they are also from Aurangabad.
Do you have
So
connection with the flight, nearest connection with flight?
we have flights at Mumbai, Hyderabad. Now Hyderabad is a routine, and Delhi. So these three cities we have
Direct
consistently.
flight connectivity with Aurangabad is there.
Yes. Direct flight from
Oh.
TrueJet from
Then what
Aurangabad,
else,
Hyderabad,
sir?
there since
Then
many, many years.
what else, sir? Everything is there now, that means.
Yeah, at least travel.
Apart from enucleation, what are your interest surgeries, sir? Where you show any erythroplasty or PCL, where you key you are clean and good?
Yeah. One is endourology. See, I am doing it routinely since beginning. Second is I am actively involved in kidney transplant surgery since last many years. So we almost on an average do 2 to 3 transplants in a week, at least 2 transplants in a week.
In your hospital?
No, at 4 places. I was actually doing transplant at 4 places. Now I am doing at 3 places.
So in Nayar, transplant was there when you did your MCH.
Yeah, but not many cases were done. Very few cases were done because that time also Nayar department was just coming up. And
We heard that at one time in 2010, all the three hospitals, four hospitals have female urologists as HOD.
yes, during my time,
Your HOD was also female urologist?
so she was there and she just retired. Dr.
Who?
Shobha Lal Chowdhury just retired. And
Yeah.
actually, what happened is she retired, and the seat was scrapped from Nair Hospital. So there was no MCS seat because Dr. Hemant Pathak sir was not a approved teacher by the university. So then his papers came, and then my admission got delayed because once this approval was given by the university to Dr. Hemant Pathak, then I was assigned a teacher. So I am the first student from Nair Hospital who's a student of Dr. Hemant Pathak.
Oh, very good, very good. So that's nice to know, sir. Transplant, you are doing very good. Every urologist field to do it. So with this introduction, I thank once again for accepting the invitation. Dr.
Thank you.
Manas, you please introduce officially Dr. Mahajan, sir. Dr. Manas is my co-consultant who is interested in thulium fiber laser and enucleation. He is the one who you excited me to do this. And in fact, we have taken two missions now. And he is independently doing enucleation, maybe more than 20 cases he has done independently. So he is, in
Excellent.
fact, more well-versed than me. Manas, over to you to introduce Abhay, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Good evening, one and all. It's a privilege for me to present to you all today. Today's speaker, Dr. Abhay Mahajan, sir. Sir is a chief urologist and director at Sai Urology Hospital, Aurangabad. He is a professor in urology at MGM Medical College and Hospital since 1999. His special interests are endourology, reconstructive urology, and kidney transplantation. Sir worked as a lecturer in urology at KEM Hospital, Mumbai. Sir worked as a past secretary of Aurangabad Surgical Society 2005 and 2006. One of the editors for the newsletter of West Zone Urological Society. Sir is also a secretary of the Aurangabad Urological Association from April 2013 to May 2016. Sir also worked as an editor of the newsletter for West Zone Urological Society of India for the issue of October 2020. Over to you.
Sir, how many urologists are there now, sir, before I hand over the program?
Yeah, now there are around 23 urologists
This is a span of how many years?
in Aurangabad. In
You came when to Aurangabad?
I came in 99, so there was no urologist, And in a span of 5 years, there were some 7-8 urologists. And then there's a big infiltration of urologists at present. And there are many who are going to come now.
Yeah, it's okay. I mean, we have to go on it.
Yes, it is a good thing, actually. More urologists, better for the services of the city.
Society. Great, sir. Over to you, sir. You can share the screen and present. Thank you once again.
Thank you. Thank you, Manas, for the kind introduction. Okay, so should I start?
Yes, sir. Which laptop, sir, this is?
This is MacBook.
MacBook, but I have seen differently. You clicked play button, then PPT has started.
This is Keynote, in Keynote. It is not in PowerPoint.
Ah, Keynote, okay.
My presentation is in Keynote.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir. Go.
So, good afternoon, everyone. And thank you, Priti Hospital. Thank you, Dr. Chandramohan and Dr. Manas, for giving me this opportunity. I am really overwhelmed. So I'll start my presentation. I'm going to speak on thulium fiber laser enucleation of prostate, commonly known as Thufle. I have no disclosures to make. Now, laser prostatectomy, holmium laser, is the most preferred modality to do laser prostatectomy because of its depth of absorption of 0.4 millimeter. And it excellently cuts, coagulates, ablates, and enucleates the tissue. And at present, it is considered as the gold standard for laser prostatectomy. But there are some limitations for holmium laser to be used in soft tissue. The main limitation is its wavelength of 2120 nanometer, which does not match with the water absorption coefficient of the tissues, which is around 1940. And this is the biggest advantage of thulium fiber laser. This is the biggest advantage of thulium fiber laser, where the wavelength of 1940 of thulium fiber exactly matches the water absorption peak in the tissues. And hence, the effectivity of delivery of the laser energy into the tissues is excellent with thulium fiber laser. Secondly, the thermal damage zone, if you see with the holmium laser, is around 400 micrometer, which is only 100 micrometer with thulium fiber laser. And hence, when you use holmium, there is more scarring into the soft tissue. When you use thulium fiber, there is less scarring into the soft tissue. The holmium laser can be used in pulse mode, and thulium fiber laser can be used in continuous wave or pulse mode. Now, I am going to compare holmium and thulium fiber laser only with respect to the soft tissue application. I'm not going to go into stones because we are speaking only on soft tissue. So I don't want to enumerate other advantage of TFL which are seen in stone disease. Now, secondly, if you see the beam of holmium, and there are studies which have studied the photomicrographical pictures of the beam of the holmium laser and the thulium fiber laser. And holmium produces a scattered laser beam, while thulium fiber laser produces a precise and a focused laser beam. And what are the implications of this? Now, if you use thulium fiber laser in prostate, and these studies, again, photomicrographs show that the carbonization zone and the vacuolization zone, which is created at the surface of the prostate mucosa, is only of 50 micrometer, and there is a definite coagulation zone of 500 to 2000 micrometer. And effectively, what you see that this is a precise cut which is produced, and there is a definite zone of thermal coagulation around the laser cut which is produced by the thulium fiber laser. Now, this study was so important that they actually concluded, or it was seen, that why the thulium fiber laser is better in prostate is because of its water absorption, which is less than 0.1 millimeter. It effectively cuts, coagulates, and ablates and enucleates the tissue as we are seeing it in holmium laser. And the cut is precise with a precise incision and a definite coagulation zone, which is seen with the use of thulium fiber laser. And one point I have to stress here to avoid any confusion, that the thulium fiber laser which we are talking about is entirely different from the thulium YAG laser, which was used for prostate since so many years. So we are talking about an entirely different technology here, which is not the same as thulium YAG laser. Now, if you compare thulium fiber laser for with the standard treatment of TURP, that is transurethral resection of prostate, for smaller glands, less than 80 grams, and when preoperative IPSS, quality of life, Qmax, postoperative complication, and PSA was assessed and compared between these two modalities, it was observed that the surgery time is more in TUFLEP as compared to TURP. The catheterization time is significantly less as compared to TURP in TUFLEP. The drop in hemoglobin is significantly less in TUFLEP as compared to TURP. And the PSA decrease is significantly more as compared to TURP. Now, what this shows is the TUFLEP is comparable to TURP in smaller glands in terms of voiding parameters and complication rate. And there is a substantial reduction in PSA levels after TUFLEP, which suggests that the removal of adenoma is quite significant, and hence the PSA drop is more after TUFLEP. Now, if you compare TUFLEP with larger glands of more than 80 grams, and the standard of for larger glands is open prostatectomy, hence the study compares with open prostatectomy. And what they concluded after comparing these two modalities was the catheterization time with open prostatectomy was significantly more as compared to TUFLEP. The hospital stay was more with open surgery. The drop in hemoglobin was more with open surgery. And subsequently, the blood transfusion rate was also higher with open prostatectomy as compared to TUFLEP. So it was concluded, obviously, that the complication rate with open surgery or with open prostatectomy is higher than TUFLEP. And TUFLEP significantly reduces the length of stay and allows early resumption of normal activity. Now, this is again a very specific study of a patient of 1400 patients, a huge study, which compared three modalities, HOLEP, TUFLEP, and monopolar enucleation of prostate. And it was concluded that in this study, actually, there was no significant difference between HOLEP, TUFLEP, and monopolar enucleation regarding the complication rate, either intraoperatively or postoperatively and immediate postoperative period. The complications overall with all the three modalities were significantly less, and the patient's volume and the patient's age did not affect the complication rate. Now, this was very significant finding that this study has given us, and all the three types of endoscopic enucleation can be safely performed with regardless of volume and age of the patient. So TUFLEP, in short, what they wanted to show is very safe with low complication rate. We'll just come to a small video, the way we perform this surgery. Now I'm going to show you N block enucleation of prostate. Now usually we do an N block enucleation. We don't do a two lobe or a three lobe technique that which is standardly done. I'll just tell you the what are the advantages with N block technique. This is around 90 gram prostate. You can see a small median lobe here. Both the lateral lobes are encroaching and obstructing. We first start with the left apical lobe right in front of the veru. This incision is deepened till the prostatic capsule is reached. Once this is done, we shift to the left apical incision. The laser settings which we use are usually 1.5 joules and 36.7 hertz. That is a total amounting to 55 watts. That is the maximum energy which we can be reached with this machine. Once this is done, this is the most important step of taking an circumferential apical mucosal release incision. Now, the advantage of taking this incision or advantage of doing an N-block enucleation is once you take this incision and release the mucosa at the apical region from the sphincter, further dissection will cause no traction on the sphincter, and hence the chances of stress incontinence or total incontinence are significantly less. So this is the main advantage of taking a circumferential incision just in front of the venu or veru all around, starting from the 12 o'clock position and going down till the 6 o'clock position. So once this circumferential incision is taken all around, then we deepen the incision from 5 to 7 o'clock position, that is at the base of the prostate till the capsule is reached. Now this is deepened till you can see the capsule, which is there, a white color capsule at the floor of the prostate. So once this is done, then what we do is we turn the fiber at 12 o'clock position, and further dissection is done with the fiber at 12 o'clock position. Now remember this, the fiber is always at 12 o'clock position till complete enucleation is done. This is the bladder neck, which is open at 12 o'clock position. You can see the bladder neck fibers. And now this incision is laterally deepened. This was the roof incision. So you are opening from outside in. You are going from outside in. From the veru, you are going towards the bladder neck. That is the way we do it. Now lateral lobes is the same. The 12 o'clock position incision is now deepened from 12 to 2 on one side and from 12 to 10 on other side. So from the roof, we are coming down. Always the laser fiber will be at 12 o'clock position, rotated. The complete resectoscope is rotated. Once this is done, again, we come to the base. The base is deepened slowly till we reach the bladder neck, and the bladder neck is open at the floor of the prostate. You can see the bladder neck fibers. How do you identify the bladder neck fibers? These are vertical white fibers. Once you reach vertical white fibers, you know that you are at the bladder neck. So the lobe is disconnected at the bladder neck, and the remaining attachments are done, and a single lobe will be delivered into the bladder. So there will be only one lobe to be morcellated at the end of the procedure. See that? This is only one lobe. So there's only one single circumferential incision. Once this is done, we come back towards the sphincter, and we check the integrity of the sphincter. See this, you can see the sphincter nicely moving. So we have not damaged the sphincter. You can see the veru down there. And that confirms that the sphincter is still intact.
Yes, sir.
So just to conclude, last slide, with our early experience, we have not done too many cases because the laser is new. We commend that the incision with TFL is precise. The coagulation is very effective with less bleeding, and it is as effective as TURP and HOLEP.
Yes.
Thank you. I think we can have discussion.
Thank you very much, sir. Nice. Manas.
Yes, sir.
I think you should lead the discussion because you are doing the same. You say that always to me, sir, keep 12 o'clock. Ask, sir, why you are keeping. I always keep at 6 and I sometimes go deeper. When I am going deeper, it will go deep. So let us start the discussion. See,
yes,
you proceed, Manas, please.
Yes, sir. Sir, you stressed more importance about placing the fiber at the 12 o'clock position. Sir, yes. Is it just a personal preference, or does it have any specific advantages while doing the enucleation, sir?
Yeah, no. See, the advantage is when you keep at 6 o'clock position, and when you go from below upwards or even from above downwards, it becomes slightly difficult with the hand movements. If the fiber is at 12 o'clock position and you open the bladder neck at 12 o'clock position and come down from 12 to 3 o'clock, say, on the right side, and 12 to 9 on the left side, it is very easy with the hand movements to come down and start dissecting the prostate from above downwards.
Excellent, sir. That is a very, very important point. If you go behind the pubic symphysis, go to the bladder neck and somehow reach the bladder, 80% of the job is done, is I have feeling.
Yeah.
After that, coming laterally from 12 on either side is definitely easy, sir.
Easy. Yes.
Sir, what instrument you use, sir, for enucleation? Is there any specific you use?
We are using Richard Wolf resectoscope, Richard Wolf laser operating element, and Piranha morcellator. So we have a complete set of Richard Wolf.
Of 26 French or 24
French? 26 French, 26 standard.
Yes. Sir, Piranha morcellator, any video you have, sir, if you don't mind, now can we see in your laptop by chance?
No, I don't have a
Piranha morcellator. Yes. I just wanted to see how it works.
I don't have a video.
How it works in this Mac,
but it works excellently. I have used Luminous morcellator. I am already using at MGM Hospital, where we have a 100 watt holmium laser also. So I am using 100 watt holmium laser at our medical college, and I'm using 60 watt TFL at my hospital.
Yes, sir.
There we have Luminous Morcillator, and here we have Piranha Morcillator. The advantage of Piranha is the blade is at the upper portion, and there is less likely that the bladder mucosa will come into the morcillator blade. The Luminous Morcillator is an end-on blade, and the morcillator speed is very fast. So there are high chances that you might not see the lower end of the 6 o'clock position of the morcillator blade, and it can cause bladder injury. So that is the biggest problem. It is, Piranha is very safe. Luminous is strong, but it is slightly unsafe.
Yeah.
Sir, one more question. Sir, when doing particular to this N-block enucleation, when you find the large, median, low, do you have any tips, sir, for beginners? Because yeah, since we have faced a lot of problems during N-block dissection, when we have the large, median, low, when there is a small, yeah, median lobe, there is only two lobes, it would have been easy. When it is large lobe, we feel when coming to that at the end near the bladder neck, we find a lot of difficulties, and sometimes we lost the plane and having the perforations also. Can you please guide us in that?
Yes, Manas, so I'll give you a tip how to do a large medial lobe with N-block enucleation. Okay, now initial incision will be at the floor incision where you start deepening. What you do is on the field or on the screen, you keep 50% of the prostate in view and 50% of the capsule in view. Always do that. It should never happen that the capsule is more seen and the prostate is less seen, or prostate is more seen and the capsule is less seen. With that, you will always be in the center of the screen. Your laser fiber will be in the center of the screen. That is one point. Secondly, whenever you are hitting the laser, don't hit the capsule, hit the prosthetic tissue,
yeah,
at the junction. So you will never have false passage, and you will never go in the prosthetic capsule, or you will never create perforation. Secondly, as you keep on lifting the prostate from the floor, the medium lobe will go up and up. So you have to keep on assessing and going towards the prosthetic tissue, not go to down. If you go down, then either you will have a subtrigonal dissection, or you might damage the orifice. That is the biggest disadvantage, or probably the biggest care you have to take during N-block enucleation is you have to prevent damage to the orifices. Because during the floor dissection, if you go deep, you are going straight in the orifice. You can just reset the orifice with the laser fiber. So as you keep pushing the lobe, median lobe up, you have to look up towards the median lobe, so that 50% of the prostate is visualized, and down 50% of the capsule is visualized. So once the lobe goes up, you have to tilt the scope upwards. So always you will be on the lobe. You will never go below. You will never have trigonal injury or injury to the ureteric orifices.
Point well noted, sir. Sir, did you notice while doing TFL, when compared to the holmium, that energy does thulium fiber laser doesn't dissect the tissue well, but it cuts well.
Yes.
Definitely cuts well. But yes, did you notice that compared to holmium, the dissection power of this laser is less?
Yeah. I perfectly agree with you. There are some disadvantages of TFL, and probably those are there with 60 watts. That is what I personally feel, because 100 watt laser, when you are comparing with 100 watt luminous, or sorry, 100 watt holmium and 60 watt TFL, the comparison is not correct. When we start using 120 watt TFL, then probably we'll come to know what is the speed of the laser, because definitely the software, though we are keeping the same settings, say about same settings of 60 watt with 120, the software calibration is always different. The delivery of the energy is always different. So that is what we have to compare. And TFL is definitely slightly slower for larger glands.
Yes.
So that is what I have observed.
Great.
And since all the studies which you quoted of Dimitri Akino, all the studies, he has used 120, 150 watt thulium fiber laser, which is not available in India.
Correct.
But in those studies, if we go and start doing in the initial phases, we felt little bit of complications. We felt little bit of drawbacks of this thulium fiber laser.
Yes, I agree with you. So probably that is because we are using 60 watts. So for larger glands, it will take more time, which doesn't happen with holmium laser.
Sir, one more thing. What's the fiber you use for enucleation, sir?
For enucleation, I use 600. 600. Yes.
Even same thing for even the bladder tumor enucleation, also same thing?
Yes, yes. 600 is better. For bladder tumor, you can use 400, but 600 is faster and better.
So, what will be your post-op protocol, sir, for catheter?
We remove catheter on third day, all patients. That is after on third day we remove the catheter. That is after 48 hours. And if there is hematuria, probably while we might delay the catheter removal for a day. But usually our protocol is to remove on third post-operative day.
For every patient will be there in the hospital for 3 days, sir, or they go home and they come back after 3 days?
Sometimes we discharge the patient next day also and call for catheter removal if they are from the from our city only. But patients who are coming from rural area, we have to keep them and remove the catheter and then send them home.
Actually, you are telling the correct truth. We also remove catheter on day 3. We don't send the patients mostly. We keep them and remove because they may not be happy.
Yes.
I am really surprised on day 1 catheter removal. I have never done. But a lot of people are doing. That is good. But yeah. Some mucosal healing, some amount of inflammation reduced.
I perfectly agree. Their chances of retention are very high when you remove next day. That is what I observed.
They will be very unhappy to put the catheter back.
Absolutely, I agree with you. I perfect because all the studies they remove the now they are removing the catheter on same day in the evening.
I'm not able to understand. Great.
I don't know why there is such a hurry to remove the catheter.
India, in our practice, yeah. We were never in hurry and are very happy with the second day, third day removal.
Yes.
They go and they stay happily and then hematuria will not be there. Readmission after post-op day 3 removal is very, very rare. All in India we have to consider. They don't mind 1 day or 2 days. But Absolutely. If any problem arises, they will feel bad.
Yeah. Aurangabad, there is a lot of peripheral drainage. So what we have observed that even if we remove the catheter and he's warding well, he will stay one more day in the hospital.
Yes. And that too in our own hospital, it doesn't make any cost.
Yeah, absolutely.
So same logistics of Western countries, we cannot apply here.
No, I perfectly.
In India, people can afford taking leave 2-3 days easily than Western countries.
Yes, I agree with you.
They
and
take
there is
leave
no
happily and they are retired and their children come and stay happily. They will sit in the hospital and go.
They enjoy the hospital stay.
They enjoy the hospital stay, in fact. You really told correct.
Sir, one question
I want to ask you, sir. I have done around Manas has done, me and I have done the enucleation. I do little bit mechanical and then mechanical laser, but not as much as bipolar enucleation, so that my speed improves when compared to normal because it's less power. I use mechanical after, but exactly the point you told, all around cut the mucosa, go into the anterior. After that, when you are sweeping, you have not used mechanical at all in your video.
That
is the ideal way of doing it. But I use little sweeping so that some amount of tissue sweeps, then I cut. Sweeps, cuts like that. You don't sweep because ideal laser enucleation, you are not supposed to sweep.
Yes. I personally feel that if you do mechanical dissection, there is definitely a drag on the sphincter.
Will be there.
And some urge incontinence or stress incontinence, some incontinence will be there for a few days, which will definitely recover. I am not saying that it will cause any major problem, but I never do mechanical dissection. I just keep on cutting and I let the prostate fall on itself towards the bladder and then drop the prostate in the bladder.
Very honest, you are. Very nice, sir. That it will take time, little bit, half an hour more.
Yes, I agree with you. It takes time. Our resection rate is 1.5 gram per minute, not less than that. We cannot do faster than that. So, a 60 gram gland will take around 1 or 15 minutes at least for
Absolutely
the manipulation. So, but morcellation is fast.
Morcellation is fast. I don't know. We used to remember 10 years back, morcellation is very difficult. It is taking only 5 to 8 minutes.
Absolutely. Same question I was asked in Bezone, that how much time you take for morcellation. I told them 10 to 15 minutes. They said it is impossible.
15 minutes.
Yeah, but we have never spent more than 10-15 minutes for morcellation.
No, majority of the presentations, it was not told like this.
Yeah, I don't know. But
we should learn it. I think we should learn properly, and lobe should be continuously attached to the marsillator.
Yes, yes, now, I agree with
you. Sir, adding to that, now all the recent marsillators are all having the capacity about 10 grams per minute.
Yes.
10 grams per second, actually, to say.
Yes.
So all the Wolf, Piranha, and the latest call shows, all they have the 10 grams per second.
Yes.
10 grams per second.
Per second, the finishing clock. So, so 70
per
grams
probably per minute,
10 grams per minute, so that 70 grams you should be finished off by 7 minutes. That's
7 correct. Minutes. Yes, correct.
Good point. 10 grams per minute.
Per most minute.
Piranha, do you have what is the mode? Like suction is there, water is there, how water goes, how suction, what is the mechanism?
Yes, Piranha has got a single foot switch.
Okay.
It doesn't have a dual foot switch.
Okay.
The lower foot switch is marsillator mode. So once you press, the blade will start moving. And whenever you have to do suction, same foot switch on the upper side, there is one more foot switch for the suction. So you press that and water will get sucked. That's the only two mechanism that Piranha has.
Okay. What is, you insert through the TURP outer sheath or through the nephroscope?
No, I have a dedicated morselloscope.
Wolf.
Wolf one. So we use morselloscope through the Wolf outer sheath. We remove the inner sheath.
Yeah, I got the point. So outer sheath 26, morselloscope is 24. And
yes.
Your Manas, what is the size of these? Sir, Babai sir, whoever maybe. This probe, what will be the size? Around 12 French?
10
blade, no?
10 French.
Blade is 12, I think 12 French. Blade is 12 French.
It will be 12 French. And yes, water flow will be good, sir. Inflow.
Water flow is good. Yes, absolutely good. There is
you
no
have two inflows or one inflow in this, your this thing?
I use two inflows with bladder fully distended so that the mucosa doesn't come near the blade.
Okay.
So
you also suggest keeping a hand slightly, always have a look at the suprapubic region and like that?
Sometimes. Okay. But what I do is I put an inflow. And from the outflow also, we connect one more IV set and start irrigation from outflow also. So the bladder is completely well distended and morselation is easy so that the mucosa doesn't come anywhere near the blade of the morselator.
Very good.
Sir, two, three questions from chat box. Can I ask?
Yes.
Yeah. Sir, do you have any specific positioning for enucleation, sir, compared to TURP? Do you have any special positioning? Lithotomy position?
No, we do it in a standard lithotomy position. We don't give any, we give slight head low, not much, because if the head low is more, then the prostate goes down, it becomes very steep when you go towards the bladder neck. But slight head low we give so that once we enucleate by gravity, it falls towards the head end of the patient. It doesn't come on your sheath. Slight head low, that is the only
change. What are your anticoagulant protocol for enucleation, sir?
We usually don't use any tranexamic acid or any routinely. But if we feel that the prostate is very vascular or after the enucleation or during the enucleation, the vision is not good, then only we use anticoagulants. But otherwise, we don't use for the bleeding. You're talking about anticoagulant therapy.
Yes, Yes, sir. Patients on antiplatelets.
Antiplatelets, yeah. So clopidogrel, we always stop. We don't continue.
Four days
prior to the procedure. Aspirin, we can continue if the patient is high risk. If he has undergone recent angioplasty or a cardiac bypass surgery, you can continue aspirin. Doesn't make any difference.
Sir, only thing is, I don't know, sir. Abhay, sir. This aspirin clopidogrel, we always stop 3 to 4 days. Even in RIRS, it causes some bleeding.
Yes. For routine patients, we also stop. We don't continue. Patient has recently undergone angioplasty or a bypass and the cardiology doesn't allow to stop because it is not 6 months after his procedure, then sometimes we just stop for 1 or 2 days aspirin and then we continue with the procedure.
Yeah.
But routine patients, we stop both the drugs. And routine patients,
in future, this will be a major concern because they are becoming prophylactic drugs nowadays. They are so much used.
Yes.
Every patient will have that.
Every patient is on some either of the drug.
It is a major subject now. Enucleation.
Yes. I agree.
So one more question. So about few briefly about mucosal sparing enucleation. Have any experience about that?
No, I have not done any mucosal sparing.
Nowadays, that Professor Herman is propagating mucosal sparing enucleation.
Yes, sir. But we have not done any.
Sir, and about slim and ultra slim hole, tried anything of lesser working elements? Sir?
No, that also we have not tried. Actually, we were planning, but the feedback was the vision is not that good as with 26 French receptoscope. That is what I have learned from people who are doing with a smaller receptoscope. So the flow becomes less, and sometimes with vascular glands, you are not able to see properly. So I think we are happy with 26 French. We do a good Otis before putting the sheath. So it prevents any stricture.
Specifically for this in-block enucleation, do you find any cost benefit compared to the two-lobe or three-lobe technique in particular towards the usage of the irrigation fluid, sir?
Yeah, it becomes slightly faster. The time taken is slightly less as compared to two and three-lobe technique. We have not compared actually. Although we note all the enucleation times in all the process, but we are looking at that. But definitely, it takes less time with N-block enucleation.
Because the plane is well developed and quickly we move in the plane.
Yes.
We need and to develop 2-3 times. One time, if you develop plane at 12 o'clock, yes. As you shown into bladder neck region, retropubic region going parallel. Yes. Oh, that if you get that changed my perception toward
yes. Yes.
I'm really enjoying that.
And so, two-lobe enucleation, obviously, you have to take one center incision, complete unit.
Oh, that will take from 10 minutes, it will take.
Yes, yes. It definitely takes more time.
More
but
time.
This is faster. Enucleation is faster. Yes.
One more question.
Yeah.
Do you have any exact point at the, you showed that marking of mucosal marking at the 12 o'clock position?
Yes.
With respect to the Veru, do you have any fixed point where that 12 o'clock position should be? It should not be at the exact 12 o'clock position from the Veru, or it should be around 1 or 2 centimeters anteriorly. Is there any fixed position for that 12 o'clock position marking?
Yes, yes, yes. The lower incision will be just in front of the Veru, yes, but the 12 o'clock incision, it is better to take more proximal to the Veru rather than going
towards the bladder. Go towards the bladder.
Yes, yes. Then the eclipse which we create or all around which we go, it is easier. If you come beyond the Veru at 12 o'clock, it is very difficult to dissect the prostate all around. And even if a small frill remains at 12 o'clock, because the amount of gland at 12 o'clock is always less as compared to the amount of gland in laterals and the base of the prostate. So little bit, even if it remains, suppose, it will not cause any problem. So 12 o'clock should be slightly away from the Veru, proximal to the Veru.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Very good point. Very good point it is. I think you have gone into the depth after buying. Since how long you are using the TFL, sir?
Almost 2 years now, Chandramohan.
RIRS also?
Yes, yes. We are routinely doing RIRS, mini per and Thuflep with our machine. We must have done a lot of mini pers. Actually, I do RIRS also, but I am a PCNL fan.
For the audience's sake, we three will quickly share the energy and frequency because this is a last question. Manas, is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Manas, is it okay?
Yes, sir.
So, I use for fragmentation of the stone 1.1 and 10 we use 1 and 10 and for the popcorn we use 200 hertz 100 to 200 and 0.1 to 0.2 energy. What is the energy setting you use for the stone, sir? Generally, mini perk, yes. I am asking.
Yeah. See, as you know, there are three menus in our machine. So we take the fragmentation and dusting mode for mini perk. And usually we do mini perk only in fragmentation mode. We yes. don't use dusting mode because there is
correct.
No point in dusting.
Correct. You are very practical. You are very
larger fragments are going to come out, so no point in wasting time. The normal setting with fragmentation is 1 joule and 10 or 15 hertz. That is enough for 90% of the patient.
Yes, that is a golden setting. 1 and 10.
Yes. 1 by 10 or 15. Rarely we use 1/20. So very okay. simple, only one setting for fragmentation mode in Miniperf, 1/10 or 1/15. That's
very
all.
Very
and
good.
If it is a very hard stone, large stone, taking more time, then we increase it to 1.5/10. Again, 15 watts, not more than 15.
Very
so
good.
Increasing the energy to fragment the stone faster, but
yes.
keeping the frequency low, not increasing the frequency.
Got the point, got the
this
point.
For RIRS, then we take the other setting, that is dusting and popcorning. This
very
setting.
Correct, correct, correct.
For dusting, again, our maximum watts is not more than 15. We never use more than 15 for dusting. And popcorning, as you said, it starts from 0.025 joules. So we either keep 0.5 joules or 1 joule rarely. For 0.5 is enough for popcorning. And we increase the frequency as we depending upon the stone hardness. That's all.
Fantastic. You have gone really into practical. And what about the any coagulation in the thulium inoculation?
Coagulation. Yes.
Usually
that
it is coagulative as such, you don't see a rare bleeder, but
yes.
if you coagulation mode is there in TFL, right
yeah.
left side, so that
yeah.
you
we have used the coagulation mode also.
Yeah, yeah.
But what has happened is we were not very happy with the coagulation mode. So what we do is, like in holmium laser, for enucleation, we use 1.5/35 or 36, which is around 55 watts. For coagulation, we use 1/20 or 1/25. Same settings.
What is your coagulation setting? Manas, what is your coagulation setting?
We commonly use 0.1 joules and 300 watts, basically coming to about 30 watts, sir. So it has
we are good 0.1 into 300.
300 hertz. We are very happy with the coagulation. So we could coagulate all the major bleeding vessels also.
Yes, yes. So we also not go more above 25 watts for coagulation, reduce the frequency and energy and then coagulate. But there is a separate coagulation mode.
Yes, 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 yes.
We don't use that for coil. It is not very effective. So
try karna sir, 0.1 and 300.
Hertz. Better.
Yes,
because this thulium fiber laser, I must tell you, sir, so many permutation combination there. Better better take 3-4 who are, like you are using more than 2 years. Salim Mohammed
yes.
is using. I am using 3 years now. Very early
yes.
first mission I have taken. If
yes.
possible, we all will have a little bit of understanding. One may have better setting, other may, because too many permutations and combinations are there.
Perfect.
As this
perfect.
Laser in future probably. Any person who is using more than 2 years, we will take them for a group discussion in the Pure and tell
correct.
Their settings, only setting, no technique, no technique.
Correct.
Then
that will be
for youngsters and for us also, very useful.
Yes.
Actually, for enucleation, Manas only keeps settings. Sometimes I don't remember. I am very good at holmium settings than thulium fiber laser, because by the time I have taken, these people are changing this thing.
Yes.
But anyway, very nice presentation, sir. Very, very, very practical.
One
yes.
more question. Sir, have you, what pulse you use, sir? Short pulse, long pulse, medium pulse, sir?
Yeah, short pulse. Short pulse. We did some 10-15 cases with long pulse,
yes.
but we were not very happy. When we shifted to short pulse, the delivery of energy with short pulse is much, much better with soft tissue in pulsate. So short pulse is the best in pulsate. Then long pulse or medium pulse.
Okay.
Excellent.
So we used to use only short pulse, sir. Of late,
yes.
not 2 cases we did with long pulse. We felt
yes.
it was good actually.
Okay. Other way around. Okay.
Not good. We felt a little bit different.
Different. Yes, yes, yes. I think what Chandramohan sir said, like that, we have to have this permutation and combinations and discuss among ourselves to
yes, yes.
get best settings.
Yeah.
So we can.
Those who are doing more than, I think 10 people are only doing in India regularly this. And these 10 people will definitely give their opinion. Today, you
yes.
told very clearly 2-3 points, very straightforward point that may, see 12 o'clock position, Manas also every time tells, I'm not able to use because I feel hand is rotated like this in 12. Somehow, I rotate.
No, you keep like this. You
yeah.
Once you rotate, you keep like this. Your
yeah.
thumb here, yeah. So, instead of doing like this, once you rotate, you have to keep like this and just, this movement is required.
I'm a little bit slow, but you and Manas are showing same thing. He also tells be close to the prostate so that you don't go. I will be slightly closer to the capsule and take a layer off from the capsule. that sometimes deepens. I have seen, because we are all in learning phase now, sir. I have done around 20, he has done 20 previous. Maybe your video is very good, and you have not used mechanical force, but definitely, sir. Sir.
Yeah, have you used continuous mode, both of you?
No, sir.
I tried continuous mode, which causes evaporation of the prostate in our machine.
There is also setting like a vaporization mode also.
Yes, yeah, that is what continuous vaporization.
How much wattage you use, sir, in that one?
So in that, maximum what you can reach is 60 watts. You cannot go above 60. And vaporization mode actually works in continuous mode of laser. But what I found is, I tried that to do vaporization. There is a lot of charring when you use in continuous mode. So that's why I start thinking that probably patient will have a lot of irritative symptoms post-operatively. So that's why I wanted to ask whether you have used in
continuous mode. No, sir. Yeah. We are also thinking about that vaporization thing. We have thought that after the enucleation, if there is any small bits are remaining, you can use the vaporization mode to remove.
Then you can.
So mainly it works like a green light laser, I think, sir.
Yes. Vaporization mode. But it is slow also. It is quite slow.
Depth of penetration will be also very less because of the charring effect. Once you get a little bit charged, that penetration will also less, I think. We haven't tried, sir. We'll try it, sir. Once we'll try it, definitely.
Sir,
I think we should do.
Yes, sir. We can do a combined study also on this time duration. It will be very good. We look into, sir, because you have told very nicely. The one point, see, the aim of the discussion is, we were all worried about the cost. Now it is coming around 40 lakhs in Mankej also. We are not sure which company is selling what. Around 40 lakhs if you are buying, you can do URSL, you can do RIRS, you can do enucleation, you can do bladder enucleation. And you need not worry that I have never done it. Because a lot of patients ask, do you do laser enucleation?
Correct.
Naturally. Because large gland, they feel that bleeding is less. It is true also. Whatever patient is expecting is also true. When you have Marcellator, which is around 10 to 12 lakhs and in Coral Stage and Piranha, maybe little costly, but good, both of them. You feel it is good, sir, because laser fibers are not getting damaged for last 2 years for me.
No, they are not getting damaged. Absolutely.
Mission is also sturdy.
I agree with you. The recurring cost is quite less. So the newcomer should not worry about buying this laser.
Yes.
It is one time cost, recurring cost is significantly less. I agree with you.
Because blast sheet is not there. This blast sheet Omium, n number of times I have changed for, it will cost around 40,000, 45,000, which will be.
I was using Holmium laser 20 watts for last 7 years.
Even I am.
And blast sheet problems were repeatedly coming.
I lose one blast sheet.
Correct. I must have spent at least 50,000-60,000 on blast shield only.
Yeah, I also same. So this is a common point which is approved. See, if everybody express, there are no conflicts of interest, obviously. It's only to help the audience, for instance, because a lot of people are asking. And do you agree that popcorn is very fast in thulium fiber laser, na, sir?
I perfectly agree. For stone, there is no laser like thulium fiber laser.
Yeah, no popcorn, laser.
Popcorning is beautiful in RRS. Even dusting mode is very nice in RIRS.
Yeah, very, very nice.
At the end of RIRS, you just see sand in the PC sand system. Yes.
Without much handwork, you can keep in center and do it.
Yes, I agree with you.
Do you feel any heat damages? I have not done major heat, but one or two cases I have seen stricture. But very high we have used, 55 watts. That is not correct.
Yes. No, stricture, I feel when you are using in ureter, our settings in ureter are not more than 6 watts, whether you are using fragmentation mode or whether you are using a dusting mode, maximum we use is 6 watts. That is the minimum which is available with the machine.
0.6 and 10, I think. 0.6
and
10.
0.6 and 10.
1 joule or 6 hertz.
Or 1/6. So what we do is, if it is an impacted stone, we use fragmentation 1/6, make bigger 3-4 fragments, and just put the forceps and retrieve them. Don't try to dust in the ureter. Because more the use of laser in the ureter, the chances of stricture will be very high. 100%. And in ureter, you can always put a grasper or a basket and remove the fragments.
100% correct. Very
nice. That is what we are doing with pneumatic lithodripter.
Very nice. Excellent. So
that is what we are doing.
Total 150 I have seen, sir, the audience. This is a common topic, and they are, by tomorrow, definitely it will be around 500, 600. really, this is the first time I am interacting scientific content. You are very honest, actually. Your answers are crisp, practical. Like, you have used it and you know it and you answered. Very happy. So I hope, Manas, we are in time, 1 hour. Should we conclude the session?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Abhay sir, for sparing valuable time. And more so, very, 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 very practical and honest you are. And I am able to appreciate, and of course the audience will definitely feel comfortable with this answer, because a lot of people, daily one call comes to me, sir, what is this, what is that, is it cost effective? If 2-3 people share the same, probably if 10 people share the same, its value increases. I think enucleation can be done with thulium fiber laser enucleation. Large glands also can be done, maybe 15 minutes, 20 minutes more time, no matter, we can finish it. And the marcellator will not take time. This is what our opinion and Abhay sir opinion. So thank you, audience. Thank you, Abhay sir. Thank you, Manas, for having this session. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.